hoping desperately at this moment that my glasses are in fact on the top of my head. Yes, that's a good thing. I'm pleased about that. I realize I'm the only thing standing between you and the rest of your lives, but I have in front of me what currently is a draft of my first 10,000 character tweet, and I thought I'd like to read it to you, because it's very important to proof these things before you press that sort of instant social media button. Unfortunately, my container load of platitudes that I normally carry around with me are stuck in port in Las Vegas after I used many of them at CES and they didn't arrive back in New York in time for today. So I apologize for that. And I actually wrote this sitting in my little cottage by a wood stove between Christmas and New Year, which makes old people reflective at that time of year, because you kind of in that period of delusion when you think that somehow those 2 weeks, that next year will somehow be different, better, or easier. And of course, you're always wrong year after year. But the AdExchanger folks asked me to sort of, you know, look forward into 2016, which normally just leaves me crying like a baby. But anyway, so here we go. Here's the tweet. It sort of starts here. So it says, the gap between the last Monday before Christmas and the flight to Las Vegas to CES is for me, and I think many others, the reflecting pond of our business. And some happily see the sky reflected in the water and think this is all going to be marvelous. And others less happily see apparently limitless and disturbing depths before them. And depending on which side of this perspective you are, it separates the optimists from the pessimists. So I thought we should look back before we look forward. I'm particularly good at making predictions about the past. Advertising in 2015, and forgive me for calling it advertising, I've been in this for a while, was the year of apparently very little truth and even less reconciliation. A year in which trust in absolutely everything was questioned, from supply chain integrity to agency and ad tech business practices. Questions were asked and they were unresolved. And I did speculate as to whether or not March the 23rd, 2014, the day of the Wall Street Journal article, really was the day in which network and other sellers became aware that more than 30% of traffic was fraudulent, or whether it surprised all of them as much as it surprised all of us. 2015 was the year in which business partnership across the sector was reframed as vendor management and all that that means, and the year that everyone knew that the system that we knew was broken and only replaced by a system of challenged faith and incomplete science, or better said, we replaced a broken system with a broken system. 2015 was the year of claim, counterclaim, and protestation, a year of declaimed certainty met with a variable balance of hope by some, doubt by many, and cynicism by many more. And our business really turned into a fact-checking version of the Republican primary season. Certain things, however, seem to me to have become immutable truths. That the linear delivery of television, on which our business has relied for so long, is in decline, especially to younger audiences. Cord cutting is real, there's no point being a denier. That subscription video on demand is becoming the fastest growing mode of long form content consumption, but that the assumption that subscription video on demand will always be ad-free is incorrect. That addressability possibly as a precursor to or a proxy for programmatic delivery of TV advertising is a real market and people are making real money out of it. The notion that everything that can be delivered programmatically will be, first display, then video, and now nascent markets in both out of home and television, for which I'm both very excited. It was the year that mobile really did overtake desktop in almost all aspects of digital media behavior. Although it's tempting to forget that desktop itself remains at a 4-year average, so the desktop is an important part of our ecosystem still. Not everyone would have you believe that. It was the year that we saw ad avoidance spiraling, forcing a rethink by publishers and advertisers alike, and ad blocking will continue to be a topic at a certain level for a period. It was the year that the app ecosystem, first in smartphones and then tablets, then on TV and now cars and watches, started to swallow the consumption of media and indeed access to services. And it was the year that Facebook and Google finally came to dominate the ecosystems of both audience and data supply. in part at least as a consequence of their ownership of the most used apps, logged in user data, and cross-device tracking that no one else could match, and a type of attribution that came with them. And they did it without the inconvenience of the costs of content creation, which is a great help to any media company. And finally, it came true in 2015 that advertisers would attempt to reset the business models of both the sellers and intermediaries like us and like many of you as a consequence of doubt of certain financial demands within their organizations and uncertain trust in terms of business practices and supply chain integrity. And anyone that thinks uncertainty is over will be disappointed. Six factors are going to drive the next level of uncertainty. As we resolve ourselves to a long-term slow-growth economy, the pressure on cost, driven a lot by zero-based budgeting, is going to come at the expense of innovation in everything from media strategy to new product development. The pressure on privacy will mount again, particularly in Europe. The pressure on data protection will grow. And this is going to threaten the expected cookie-based targeting and, less expectedly, the value or the potential for umbrella opt-ins of the dominant first-party data collectors. It's possible that ad blocking will spread into the in-app environment. That will be a major development. There will be pressure on venture capital investment into the app development community market and install market overall if usage continues to concentrate around the top 30 or 40 apps in the market. And there'll be a new level of scrutiny by advertisers into the real value of data, voodoo audience numbers, and third-party measurement. And lastly, there's going to be a second wave of tech stack development as some of the rigid stack commitments decline in value in terms of offering performance that actually lags the expectation of marketers. It's the end of the beginning of the CIO, CMO era, more to come. In aggregate, these factors together pose, it would be reasonable to say, a systemic and sometimes existential threat across the value chain. Without innovation and NPD on the advertiser side, the ad economy runs low on fuel. We only do well when people want to drive demand. If demand creation is simply substituted by share shifting, we have a zero-sum game on our hands, in which claiming the credit is more important than driving growth. That's not the recipe for a healthy market. If privacy and the policies that create advantage for some are re-examined and unbundled, the extended ecosystems of targeting, ad deployment, and attribution are going to start looking like a Swiss cheese. They will be full of holes with bells on. Real context, and this is good for the publishers and creators of content, I think will rise in value. Networks claiming, and my favorite trade show sign of the year from Demexco last year was, we have 175,000 premium publishers in our network, and I was trying to imagine what they might be, but networks claiming things like that will not prosper. If ad blocking hits the app market, even the giants are going to feel some pain, to say nothing of the advertisers who are already competing in a difficult market for mobile screen inventory. If the VC market wobbles, the app install market itself, a vital part of the digital economy, and we've heard many people, I guess, over the last 2 days talking about one of the things that people optimize for is ad installs, well, they're going to stop optimizing for ad installs if they're not getting app activations and consistent usage. So I think that's something to watch. If advertising alone won't drive success in the dominant app environments, it's going to necessitate a new cost, and that cost is going to be app-specific creativity when people are making things for both the format and the use state for each and every app they do business with. And that means they have to go far beyond advertising and into extensive content narratives and services that remain valuable over time. If advertisers don't see a return soon on what they've come to think of as one-to-one targeting, and soon as the first half of 2016, we could see a fundamental restructure and a fundamental reevaluation of the market and data. And a data pricing hierarchy will evolve with actual behaviors at the top, driven by transaction behaviors, and loosely inferred behaviors at the bottom of the pricing chain. Another shakeout will come. And finally, we're reaching the day of reckoning as I mentioned before, for the first wave of the CIO era of marketing and of some of the new entrant ad tech vendors. It's likely that fixed stacks comprised of single or multiple managed service components will migrate to a meta stack of SaaS components that will demand new and better UI, more interconnect flexibility, and new levels of investment. And that may be unavailable to businesses, some of which went public on valuations based on multiples of billing, not margin or profit. There are challenges ahead. It's our view on that topic that the client focus should be on internal data symmetry. The most important component of that is the selection and management and consistent use of the DMP. If the DMP is the repository for customer and other first-party data and the one theoretical constant in an ever-moving world, that's the place you should align the business, that's the place you should keep data safe, and that's the place you have to work out how to unlock that data, keeping it safe and proprietary, but enable its activation in the marketplace. And if internal data symmetry is the focus for clients, it means that external symmetry and the achieving of that becomes the purpose of the agency and the marketing team it supports. Asymmetry, put simply, is the application of superior knowledge to create marketplace advantage by knowing more about a customer or an impression than your competitor or the seller does. Media has always been about internal symmetry to create external asymmetry. As for GroupM, reports of our death and that of our peers, as Lord Shaftesbury once said, have been somewhat exaggerated. We've concluded, after almost no thought at all, that there is sustainable advantage into being a scale player at the intersection of the disruptors and the disrupted, and there are many of both. Our business is simple, which is a good thing. Together with WPP, we create, distribute, and measure brand messaging, audiences, and effectiveness. We're globally distributed, and that global distribution leads us to a certain way of thinking and a commitment to certain things. And I wanted to use this opportunity, because I don't think this is about GroupM, although this little bit is, but I think it's important to the market. We're committed to the creation of ads in any and every format. And we're committed to the delivery of ads that can be seen and heard. And we admit a prejudice to them being seen or heard by humans. We're committed to marketplace integrity in respect to viewability and all its consequences, and to the prevention of fraud. And I think we've done a lot to lead and help collaborate with the market to move that forward. We're committed to content beyond ads. We just don't make ads and run them anymore, but we're committed to create content beyond ads that allow brands access to and integration with sources, some of which we own part of, like Vice and Refinery29 and Fullscreen, and many that we don't own part of, like Snapchat, like BuzzFeed, and many others. We're committed across the Kantar organization and GroupM to the collection, ownership, and integration of high-value behavioral, transactional, and audience data from sources as diverse as set-top boxes, point-of-sale and social search signals, loyalty programs, and with assets like Kantar, iBehavior, and our investment in ComScore and RemTrack, I think we're well-placed to do that, and I think it's going to help the industry a great deal, both in currency and currency modifiers in the years to come. We're committed in the business, and we think everyone should be, to develop a data spine, to really understand what the US consumer, the UK consumer, the Chinese consumer really looks like. Strip out the PII, but find something that persists, find something to which you can append new actions to, find stuff that you can weight those action to, clear out the old, add the new, and differentiate the important from the unimportant. And most importantly, make sure that that data spine is independent of any one source of inventory or any one source of tech. We owe this to ourselves, we owe this to our clients. And that data spine to us is at the heart of our strategy for internal data symmetry that in the future will create the asymmetry in the market for our clients. We're committed to an integrated, but now what we call a meta-stack technology strategy. As many of you know, we bought 24/7 in 2007, And from 24/7, we created the Media Innovation Group and Xaxis and its own DMP turbine. We're an investor in AppNexus, which we're proud of, and just recently we purchased Exchange Labs in Europe. And the Exchange Labs Proteus, often misquoted as Prometheus platform, allows us rapid DSP integration and to work with everyone in the value chain. And we've also invested heavily even in tools that help us use the Google stack more effectively, and we are a frenemy of Google's no more. We're on the same side, and as our purchase of Essence Digital indicated, it suggests that we're as committed to the Google stack and Google inventory as anyone else. We never saw build, buy, and partner as an or, we always saw it as an and. And so there'll be no polemics about proprietary stacks from us, but our role is to make sure that we can create a scenario for our clients and people where we achieve an end game of all the data, all the inventory, all the time, in as close to real time as possible. And that's the focus of our business. If we do that, and we continue our focus and our intelligence gathering about all of the other platforms we operate on, we'll also be able to meet our commitment to omni-touch attribution that appropriately values all online channels but offline contacts as well through the vortex of the customer journey. It concerns us that attribution has moved too close to the last click. It concerns us that attribution has moved to be dominated only by the places where digital fingerprints are left. We believe many of the influences on the choices of brands, both the first time brand switching and lifetime loyalty, come from many spaces that are white space to the digital world. Things that happen in store, things that happen in private conversations between individuals, things that happen by old-fashioned things like delivery of messaging on television. And it strikes us that without omni-touch attribution, the one thing we can't do is inform the allocation process of where our clients should spend their money, upon which they should spend it, and how to optimize from there. So we hope that that commitment and our level of investment in it is sound positioning. And whilst it's an unending work in progress, which is very good for people like me, because you can, as they say, half the battle is to show up and get paid. It turns out that it's much more than half the battle, and that's all going well, thanks. But we think it's sound positioning, a work in progress, and we think it's the basis for long-term sustainability, not just in GroupM and WPP, but in the overall marketing and media services area. We think, alongside the other people in this room, our vendor partners and our clients, that we'll continue to provide value. Now, last year there were a few media pitches. Some of you will be aware of that. I think some of people are still dreaming in PowerPoint as we speak. We won't name them all. I mean, if we looked at last year, we'd say our glass is half full rather than half empty, but we do believe we're going to do okay. And I think we do believe that we're going to achieve a return on the investments we're making in data. We do believe that we're going to receive a return on our scale, and that will reflect the return on the scale that's demanded by our clients. We also believe, which is as important as anything, that our strategy, and was why we encourage it in the business, has become attractive to talent in an environment of intense competition. And we think what we've done, and we think all businesses like us should do, is encourage an entrepreneurial class that can build new business models of really robust platforms that can be deployed. And the potential for those people to be rewarded and promoted is enormous. And Brian Lesser, who was at 24/7 when we bought the company and became CEO of Xaxis and is now the CEO of GroupM North America, is the poster child for the entrepreneurial class that says you can reinvent the business you're in from within. So somehow, like groups of climbers roped together, some by choice, some by necessity, at the light of dawn of 2016, you see a mighty peak, and everyone knows that there's a North Star or a mighty peak out there. The problem is, there's no one route of reaching it, and there's plunging drops in almost every direction. 2016 is not going to be a year for the average. Rather, it's going to be a year of the highest expectations from everyone. And those expectations can only be met if we do things straightforwardly and often together. And the reason's simple. Our entire commercial ecosystem depends absolutely on profitable brand growth. Without it, there's nothing. We're actually in one business, the business of generating demand and doing so with efficiency and effectiveness. That business depends on, in turn on data of integrity being used to unlock segments of potential that drive future growth and profit, and coupling that data with creative ingenuity to capture the opportunity. There's no question in my mind that the left and right brains of the advertising and marketing business are now in collision, both creatively and in media. And it's up to us to take advantage or simply be carted off the field under whichever concussion protocol applies to our business. So although it's a little late to say it, I will say Happy New Year. I'll say good luck to all of you, but this year is going to be way better to be good than it is to be lucky. Finally, a word on acronyms. I was told recently by an unreliable source that I was the first person to use a presentation with paid, owned, and earned media in it, for which I apologize profusely if it's true. It's a familiar narrative for the last decade, but I think now, with the increasing of ad avoidance, the increasing use of on-demand services, we need to change that acronym. And we need to think about content that can be found, content that will be used demonstrating value, content that will be kept demonstrating that it has continuing value, and content that will be shared. The only thing wrong with this new acronym is that F-U-K-S may be a little tricky in some circumstances. Happy New Year, good luck, and thank you.